So students, last week we had started the chapter Indigo. Until now, I think so it is very, very clear what the main idea of the chapter is about. It is about the Battle of Champaran. It was the problems that was faced by the peasants over there, the system of sharecropping, which had put them in a very difficult situation. So one of the peasants was brave enough and he went all the way to meet Mahatma Gandhi at Lucknow, where the Congress convention was going on. And then he followed him to all the places. And ultimately, Gandhi agreed to meet him at where? Kolkata, right? And so from there, he went, came to the place of Champaran, or rather, he reached Muzaffarpur. And then they started off towards Motihari, where they had heard about the peasant who had been maltreated and how the people had come out in a huge crowd because they knew that, their champion, their leader, that is Gandhi, was going to be there. He's going to represent their cause. And they all came out to show their support. And of course, here, when the people came out in large numbers, it challenged the authority of the Britishers. Till that time, what had happened was the authority of the Britisher had been unchallenged. No one had questioned them. No one had raised their voice. No one had showed the strength of unity. But this incident, it made the Britishers scared. They could not take any action because of the fear that how the peasants are going to react. And they had sent a summons to Gandhi. Gandhi refused to leave the place. He said, you cannot order me about in my own country. So as a result, he had to appear in court. And when he was there in court, the peasants, they came in large numbers to support him. And ultimately, what did the court decide? That he was sent off without any kind of punishment, right? It also changed here. One very important change about the lawyers' attitude also changed. The lawyers who were there, you know, a part of creating the fear among the peasants. So they also realize their mistake, and they realize if an outsider can come and he is ready to go to prison for the cause of our people, we live here. Why can't we work for them? Why can't we support them? And they also decided that if he was sent to jail, we'll also, you know, continue with the protest. And so when the need comes, if the need arises, we'll also go to prison. So Gandhi, he says here that the Battle of Champaran is won. When the people are aware, when the people are brave and courageous enough to stand up against injustice, any kind of battle is won. So let's continue with the chapter and let's see what happens next, okay? Yes. So here it is. Yeah, so several days later, the civil disobedient had triumphed the first time in modern India. Very important line over here. What is a civil disobedience here? The people not obeying the orders. And who led by example? It was the first person. Mahatma Gandhi there is telling that I will not follow your order. He refused that summon which was there telling him to leave the place. Okay, now here, let us continue. Gandhi and the lawyers now proceeded to conduct a far-flung inquiry into the grievances of the farmers. What was the problem of the farmers? The system of sharecropping. They were asked to pay compensation and they did not want to do that because synthetic indigo was available in the market. Okay. Depositions by about 10,000 peasants were written down and notes made on other evidence. So all this writing, all the legal writing, all the record was done. So an inquiry began. They started discussing what is the problem of the farmers. Documents were collected. The whole area throbbed with the activity of the investigators and the vehement protests of the landlords. Why do you think the landlords were protesting? Why were the landlords protesting? Landlords were protesting because if things went in favor of the peasants, they would have to pay compensation. And yes, it would be once again, we can say a very sad thing happening or a great disgrace maybe what they would feel because they were going to be giving into the demands of the peasants. And this would be the first time that such a thing would happen. So the whole area throbbed with the activity of the investigators. They're making the inquiries, they're looking into the matter, and the vehement protests of the landlords. In June, Gandhi was summoned to Sir Edward Gates, the lieutenant governor. Before he went, he met leading associates and again laid detailed plans for civil disobedience if he should not return. So he's gone to meet the authorities, the lieutenant governor, and he's also made a plan with the lawyers, with the people, that if I do not return, if I'm sent to prison or if I am detained, what is going to be the next course of action, right? So Gandhi had four protracted interviews with the lieutenant governor, who as a result appointed an official commission of inquiry into the Indigo sharecropper's situation. So Gandhi had four meetings with the higher authorities, and they appointed an official commission. So earlier, what was Gandhi and the lawyers doing? They were doing an inquiry on their own. They were collecting evidences. They were receiving the letters, right? All the legal documents they were getting ready. And now he's had a meeting with the lieutenant governor, and he has ordered a commission to look into the matter, into the Indigo sharecropper situation. The commission consisted of landlords, government officials, and Gandhi as the sole representative of the peasants. So see, there is no one actually from the peasants coming. So Gandhi is there as their representative, right? So here, whom did the commission consist of? Landlords, government officials, and Gandhi. So they are going to look into the matter. Gandhi remained in Champaran for an initial uninterrupted period of 7 months, and then again for several shorter visits. So he had come for a short while on the request of a peasant, but what happened, this visit, it extended into a longer period. So 7 months, then again shorter visit. The visit undertaken casually on the entreaty of an unlettered peasant, in the expectation that it would last a few days, occupied almost a year of Gandhi's life. So Gandhi had never expected that he would be staying here for so long. He had come there just on the request of a peasant. He thought it would be a small matter. He'd look into it, and so he did not realize the gravity of the situation, that how big a problem it was. And he had to stay on for almost a year. The official inquiry assembled a crushing mountain of evidence against the big planters. And when they saw this, they agreed in principle to make refunds to the peasants. But how much must we pay? They asked Gandhi. So Gandhi, when he started gathering evidence, and there is a mountain of evidence against the big planters. That means about the injustice that was happening with the sharecroppers. When they realized that, oh my God, so much evidence has been collected. So they came to Gandhi, how much must we pay? They thought he would demand payment, repayment in full of the money which they had illegally and deceitfully extorted from the sharecroppers. So they thought he's going to say return all the money which they had with great force, by using their authority, by calling thugs, right? By creating a fear in the mind of the people. They had extorted that money. He asked only 15%. So to their surprise, he just said 50%. There he seemed adamant, writes Reverend J. Z. Hodge, a British missionary in Champaran who observed the entire episode at close range. This is the first time that an activity of such magnitude was happening. And so this person was there observing what is happening, thinking probably that he would not give way. The representative of the planters offered to refund to the extent of 25%. Gandhi was adamant at 50, but one of the planters just made an offer that maybe, yeah, he agreed, and he said, okay, 25%. And to his amazement, Mr. Gandhi took him at his word, thus breaking the deadlock. Otherwise, deadlock means there was no negotiations, nothing was moving forward between the peasants and the landlords. right? The landlords were not ready to give even 50% repayment. And so one of them just suggested 25%, and Gandhi agreed for that also. So why did Gandhi agree for 25% when he could have got 100% of the compensation? Why did he start with 50%? Why couldn't he have asked for 100%, right? Because the peasants were illegally cheated of their money. He should have got all the money back and returned it. Why only 25%? There's a reason for that. We'll find out, okay? This settlement was adopted unanimously by the commission. So yeah, they agreed, okay, 25%. Everybody is agreeing. 25% is way, way better than 50% for the landlords. Gandhi explained that the amount of the refund was less important than the fact that the landlords had been obliged to surrender part of the money and with it part of their prestige. So Gandhi said, it is not money that is important. When these landlords, these Britishers, they had thought themselves to be so powerful, no one could stand up against them. And so even if they give 25%, it is going to be a big blow to their pride, to their prestige. So he said, more than the money, what is it? They are surrendering a part of their prestige, the reputation that they had among the peasants. But see, we are so powerful. You cannot raise your voice against us. You can't tell us what to do. We are the ones who are telling you. Therefore, as far as the peasants were concerned, the planters had behaved as lords above the law. Now the peasants saw that he had rights and defenders. He learned courage. The peasants had thought these landlords are above the law. This incident made them think again. This incident made them realize they have rights. Who have rights? The peasants have rights. And if they stand up, they will get those rights. He learned courage. Who learned courage? The peasants learned courage. The farmers learned courage. Events justified Gandhi's position. Within a few years, the British planters abandoned their estates, which reverted to the peasants. Indigo sharecropping disappeared. This is such a major turn of events this episode brought about. How was it beneficial to the peasants? They got compensation, right? Even if it was 25%. They learned to stand up against injustice. They learned courage. And yes, here, they realize that these landlords are not above the law. If their authority is questioned, they have every right to stand up against injustice. And what happened as a result of it? The British planters abandoned their estate. It was such a blow to their pride. And because they had abandoned their estates, which they had really occupied from the peasants so, so many years ago, what happened? The land, it came back to the peasants. And indigo sharecropping disappeared. The system, which was very unjust to the peasants, it disappeared. Gandhi never contented himself with large political or economic solutions. So it was not only about the political here. What is the political? They learned courage. Yes, the peasants got justice. Economic, the peasants got compensation. He saw the cultural and social backwardness in the Champaran villages and wanted to do something about it immediately. He appealed for teachers. He looked at the situation of the people over there. Not only were they politically deprived, they were economically also very, very backward. What else will say? Socially, culturally, so many changes need to be brought about. They had to be taught so many things to make their life better. He saw the cultural and social backwardness in the Champaran villages and wanted to do something about it immediately. He appealed for teachers, Mahadev Desai and Narahari Parekh, two young men who had just joined Gandhi as disciples, and their wives volunteered for the work. So these two young men, they came as teachers accompanied by their wives, and they came here to teach. Several more came from Bombay, Pune, and other distant parts of the land. Devdas, Gandhi's youngest son, arrived from the ashram, and so did Mrs. Gandhi. Primary schools were opened in 6 villages. Kasturbai taught the ashram rules on personal cleanliness and community sanitation. So yeah, so Swachh Bharat, it began so many years ago. Okay, so here, like, right, what was it? These people did not know about cleanliness. People did not know about literacy, being educated. So Gandhi wanted to make these people, you know, like, yes, more aware about things, about social changes, about culture changes, about the economic aspect of life. So he called for teachers. They came, and his son also came and joined him there. His wife came, and she helped over there regarding the cleanliness and community sanitation. Okay, so let's look at these questions. Why did Gandhi agree to a settlement of 25% refund to the farmers? Why did he agree to 25%? Because here it is not the money that was important, but along with the money, what are these people surrendering? A part of their ego, a part of their prestige, they are surrendering. So it is not only the, you know, like, economic here, but these people are learning an important lesson. It's a lesson for both the peasants, a lesson for the landlords also. So he agreed. He said any amount of money is agreeable as long as they pay. It's a big blow to their pride. It's a big blow to the position that they have. And what kind of position do they have? That we are above law. No one can challenge us. Right? So how did this episode change the plight of the peasants? So many changes happened. Not only economic changes, not only political changes, but social and cultural changes also. Learning about literacy, learning about health, learning about hygiene, right? That you are a respectable individual. You have courage. You can stand up for your rights. All this was learned here. Health conditions were miserable. Gandhi got a doctor to volunteer his services for 6 months. 3 medicines were available: castor oil, quinine, and sulfur ointment. Sorry about that. Gandhi, so health conditions. What were the things here? He's called for a doctor who volunteered his services for 6 months. And 3 medicines were given: castor oil, quinine, and sulfur. Right? What was it? For anybody who showed a coated tongue was given a dose of castor oil. For stomach problems and all, it was given. Anybody with malaria fever received quinine plus castor oil. So yes, we know this medicine, it is there for malaria. So they were given that treatment. Anybody with skin eruptions received ointment plus castor oil, right? So they were taught about taking care of their health also. That, yes, your health is very, very important. And you have to maintain cleanliness, sanitation, personal hygiene. All this was taught there. So, right? So what were the medicines which were available? What were the things that were available? Castor oil, you say, quinine, or, right, for malaria. And sulfur for skin eruptions or the skin problems that they had. Gandhi noticed a filthy state of women's clothes. He asked Kasturbai to talk to them about it. One woman took Kasturbai into her hut and said, "Look, there is no box or cupboard here for clothes. The sari I am wearing is the only one I have." So such a sad state of the peasants. The women here and the clothes they were wearing were the only ones that they had. So when Kasturba Gandhi told them about cleanliness, how you have to wash your clothes, how you have to maintain cleanliness, to change your clothes regularly, and the women saying, we don't have any cupboard or we don't have any box in our homes, and the clothes that we're wearing are the only ones that they had. So, like, you can well imagine what was the condition of the peasants, how poverty-stricken they were. During his long stay in Champaran, Gandhi kept a long distance watch on the ashram. So his ashram over there at Ahmedabad, he was taking a care of that also. He was continuously in touch with what is happening over there. He sent regular instructions by mail and asked for financial accounts. Once he wrote to the residents that it was time to fill in the old latrine trenches and dig new ones, otherwise the old ones would begin to smell bad. So once again, about community sanitation, about community cleanliness, the things that he was following over there in his ashram that he was implementing over here in the villages of Champaran also. Okay, right. The Champaran episode was a turning point in Gandhi's life. So not only was it a turning point here in the history of India, but it was a turning point in Gandhi's life. What I did, he explained, was a very ordinary thing. I declared that the British could not order me about in my own country. So he also realized an important lesson. He learned an important lesson. It was a turning point in his life that these people cannot order me around. And I am a free person in my country. No one has the authority to tell me what to do and what not to do. But Champaran did not begin as an act of defiance. Defiance means to go against the authority. It did not begin like that. How did it start? It grew out of an attempt to alleviate the distress of large number of poor peasants. This was a typical Gandhi pattern. His politics were intertwined with the practical day-to-day problems of the millions. His was not a loyalty to abstractions. It was a loyalty to living human beings. Now see, beautiful lines here, these are. So this was a turning point in the life of the peasants as well as of Gandhi. The peasants learned courage. The peasants learned that they had rights. The peasants learned that they could stand up for their rights. And Gandhi learned that, yes, in my country, no one can order me about. This was a turning point in his life also. Now, what about this problem at Champaran? Right? It was not an act of defiance. He did not want to go against here, you know, like, see, I don't obey you, I don't listen to you. It was not that. What did it begin as? To change the condition of the peasants. Now, along with that, so many things happened, like we have discussed in the previous paragraphs, the political changes and economic changes, apart, what was it, the social and cultural changes. So what did he want the people to learn? That if you stand up for something, something which is abstract, we're talking about justice, we're talking about freedom, all these things here. He made them into a reality, right? How did he make them? It by actually telling these people that you have the courage within you, you can unite, stand up against injustice. In everything Gandhi did, moreover, he tried to mold a new free Indian who could stand on his own feet and thus make India free. So he wanted that every Indian should understand courage. Every Indian should realize that you have rights. You can stand up for them. Right? So this is what he wanted. And when every Indian knew, realized that they are free, every Indian realized they have courage, they have rights to stand up for, it would make India free. It was, yes, maybe the beginning of this struggle, right? Okay, we'll stop over here and we'll continue with the chapter tomorrow. So let's just discuss a few more things about it.